Let me go to screen share and okay, so pituitary disorders, right? So you are already familiar with where the pituitary is located. As you can see in this diagram out here, you've got the brain out here, the cerebrum. You can see the cerebrum, and this is the spinal cord and the pons. And out here, the small projection, which is hanging. This is the pituitary gland. Now, if you take a coronal section in the area of the cella or the part of the skull where the pituitary is located, you will see something like this, right? So, as you can see in this diagram, you've got your optic chiasm on top, and then you've got the pituitary gland, and this is the pituitary stalk, and this is the sphenoidal sinuses, and here is the nasopharynx. And you've got your cranial nerves, this is the cavernous sinus. The cranial nerves are visible in the wall of the cavernous sinus. You can see the third, fourth, fifth, the sixth, and the V1 and V2 segments of the fifth nerve. And this is the internal carotid artery, which is sort of curving around this area. So these are the structures which you see in the coronal section. Now, what you actually, when you do an MRI, this is what it looks like. As you can see, this area is the pituitary out here, and this is the stalk, and this is the optic chiasm. So, just to make things a bit clearer, this is the optic chiasm out here, right? This is the arrow showing the optic chiasm in the MRI. And this is the pituitary, the second arrow. And this is the sphenoidal sinus, this large black area. And this dark spot out here, which is being shown by this arrow, is this the internal carotid artery flow void. So on MRI, you cannot see the artery itself, but you see a flow void. So it's called a flow void. This is the cavernous sinus, this small structure, which this is you're seeing out here. It's not as extensive as you see in this diagram. Actually, it looks much smaller on an MRI. It's this, just this area, this bright area in the corner. This is the cavernous sinus. Right. So if you take a sagittal section, this is what you would see. You go to the hypothalamus, and then the stalk, and then the anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary. Okay, so now the anterior pituitary is formed up of cells. You've got basically six type of cells there. First one is the somatotrophs. These are the growth hormone producing cells. And the somatotrophs are the most abundant cells. The most of the pituitary, 50% is made up of these somatotrophs. Then you've got your lactotrophs, which produce prolactin. And then you've got your gonadotrophs, which secrete both LH and as well as FSH. Then the corticotrophs, which secrete ACTH. Actually, they secrete POMC, and then POMC breaks down into several components, one of which is ACTH. And the thyrotrophs, which produce TSH. Now the pituitary is in control, anterior pituitary at least, is in direct control of the hypothalamus. And there are what hypothalamus hormones which dictate the secretion from the anterior pituitary. So as you can see, the GRHRH is the growth hormone releasing hormone, which comes from the hypothalamus, and this will increase the production of growth hormone. You've got the GnRH, which is the gonadotropin releasing hormone, and this stimulates the production of LH and FSH from the gonadotrophs. Then you've got the corticotropin releasing hormone, which secretes, which stimulates the corticotroph to produce ACTH. And you've got the TSH releasing hormone, which stimulates the thyrotrophs to produce TSH. So these stimulatory factors, these are transported to the pituitary from the hypothalamus by the means of a portal circulation. So if you can see out here, this is a portal circulation. If you do not recall, portal circulation is basic. Portal vessel is any vessel which begins in a capillary and again ends in a capillary. So the portal vessels travel from the hypothalamus to the anterior pituitary, and they carry these stimulatory factors to the pituitary and therefore they control the secretion of the respective hormone from the pituitary. On the other hand, if you look at the posterior pituitary, it is made up of cells. The cell bodies are in the hypothalamus, and the axons are leading up through the stalk into the posterior pituitary. And it is through these neurons that the secretion of the posterior pituitary hormones occurs. And there are two hormones. One is oxytocin, which relatively has less utility generally in the body, apart from maybe in pregnancy and lactation. And most importantly, of course, ADH, or the posterior pituitary, the vasopressin, which is also called the vasopressin, not the antidiuretic hormone. Right. So importantly, as you can see, there is nothing stimulating prolactin. And therefore, prolactin is unique among the anterior pituitary hormones. Prolactin is actually under an inhibitory control. So the stalk is containing some neurons which are delivering dopamine. The dopamine is being delivered from the hypothalamus to the anterior pituitary. And this dopamine actually inhibits the secretion of prolactin. So it's sort of an inhibitory control. So all the other cells have a stimulatory control, but prolactin has an inhibitory control. So there are some transcription factors which are involved in the development of the various pituitary cells. And these include PROP1, PIT1. PROP1 is responsible for the generation of the growth hormone producing, that is the G. It is responsible for the gonadotrophs, which secrete FSH and LH. It is responsible for thyrotrophs, and is also responsible for the ACTH secreting, or the corticotrophs. So this is just to memorize. I've written it like this. This is growth hormone, FSH, LH, TSH, and ACTH. And PIT1 is responsible for GT and A. That is, PIT1 does not is not involved in the development of the gonadal cells. And there are, and TPIT is important for the corticotrophs or the ACTH producing cells. So these are transcription factors, and deficiency of these factors can lead to hypopituitarism. So with this limited background, I will briefly show you the causes of hypopituitarism. So hypopituitarism can be congenital, it can be infectious, it can be because of inflammation or trauma, it can be from vascular causes and also from neoplastic causes. So what are the congenital causes? You can have a pituitary aplasia or dysplasia, and it can be because of these tissue factors which I showed you, and it can also be idiopathic, in which no real cause is known. It can also be because of hypothalamic problems. If the hypothalamus is defective, then the secretions will not come to the pituitary, and then the pituitary will not work properly. So the hypothalamic disorders which are known to us include the Kallmann syndrome, septo-optic dysplasia, Lawrence Moonbeetle, and Prader-Willi syndrome. So septo-optic dysplasia is again not a common disorder, but the gene is HEX1, and you have a dysgenesis of the septum pellucidum and the corpus callosum, and hypothalamic dysfunction, and it manifests with hypopituitarism apart from the other manifestations which I mentioned here. Then Kallmann syndrome is something which we sometimes see in clinical practice. You must have already read, and you must be already knowing that it includes anosmia or hyposmia along with hypogonadism. So what happens is there is a defective GnRH secretion in Kallmann syndrome, and the anosmia or hyposmia is because of the olfactory bulb agenesis or hypoplasia. So the gene is now known, it is the Calvin gene, and there are several other genes also which may cause this. And what happens actually in Kallmann syndrome is that the GnRH secreting neurons actually arise from the olfactory placode, and from there they have supposed to travel to the area of the hypothalamus. If for some reason this migration does not occur properly, then these cells do not reach the target, and because of this you're not able to get a proper sense of smell, and at the same time you're not able to produce enough GnRH, and therefore it results in hypogonadism, and which often manifests as a delayed puberty. Of course, if it's a pre-pubertal hypogonadism, it will manifest as delayed puberty, and this disorder is typically seen in males rather than in females. Then inflammatory causes, most important being lymphocytic hyperphysitis. Lymphocytic hyperphysitis is actually an autoimmune disorder which is common in the postpartum period, and it manifests in the form of a pituitary enlargement actually, and a lot of people mistake it for pituitary tumor, and some people have been operated for the same, but actually it's an inflammatory condition which subsides later on. But some patients may end up with sequelae of hypopituitarism after this has resolved. Then of course you've got hemochromatosis, which affects the pituitary, sarcoidosis and histocytosis X also. Among the infections, tuberculosis and fungal infections can affect the pituitary. Then pituitary apoplexy is basically infarction or hemorrhage occurring in the pituitary, very common in pregnancy. Infarction can also occur in diabetes and also occur in sickle cell disease. And then neoplasty, we've got tumors, you have pituitary adenomas, which can compress the pituitary and therefore lead to hypopituitarism. Craniopharyngioma is another tumor which is known to occur in this area. And because of the mass effect, it can cause hypopituitarism. Rathke's cleft cysts are developmental abnormalities. Rathke's cleft is the area from which the pituitary and other structures develop. And sometimes you've got a large cyst there which can compress the pituitary. You can also have meningiomas or metastasis in this area. And of course, trauma is important. Any surgical resection performed in this area, and specifically head injury. If you have a major head injury, you may end up with stalk section. And if your stalk is cut, then your pituitary no longer gets its trophic factors from the hypothalamus. So a couple of cases to just show what we see in our OPD. This is a 30-year-old female. She had a history of postpartum hemorrhage. She could not breastfeed the child. And subsequently, she didn't have any menstrual cycles. And she came to the GTB emergency itself with gastroenteritis and hypotension. We did not improve despite fluid and inotropic support. So this patient was already carrying a thyroid profile, and this was performed at a neighboring hospital. This is most likely from Ibhas, I think, where she landed up first. And the lab has done a good job in highlighting that the patient has got a very low free T4, whereas the free T3 and the TSH look normal. So those who have attended the hypothyroidism class or who have come to our OPD, we recognize that this is the classical picture of central hypothyroidism. When the free T4 becomes low, TSH will go up if it is a primary hypothyroidism, and TSH will really go up. It's going to go up into 30, 40, 50, 100, like that sort of thing. But here, free T4 is practically zero, and the TSH, it is hovering around the normal range. It's not elevated. So this patient has got central hypothyroidism, right? So already the marker was there, the report was there, but somebody had not really looked at the report and thought that it is central hypothyroidism. But this is the kind of pituitary dysfunction that you would see when you have a pituitary hypothyroidism. This is the MRI image of not the same patient, but a similar patient. You can see out here, this is the optic chiasm. Then this is the stalk. And you can see that the pituitary tissue, which is supposed to be here, it is almost gone. You just see a very thin rim around the corner. And this is what is also called as an empty cella. So in this patient, she had lost most of her pituitary tissue because of Sheehan syndrome or a pituitary necrosis which occurred during the pregnancy. So this patient had Sheehan syndrome. She also had her amenorrhea was because of the hypogonadism, and the shock that we were discussing were of course because of the adrenal crisis because she didn't have any adrenal reserve left. Now this is another patient who had head injury. He was 35-year-old. 5 years back he had a head injury. He was subsequently told that he should take thyroxine, but he didn't see the point of taking the drug. And his main issue currently was that he could not get an erection. And these are his reports. The blood report has been done in, I think, Rajiv Gandhi Hospital probably. And again, you can see the same pattern. Free T4 is dramatically low. It's only 0.18, but TSH is normal. So if you only order a TSH, you will say that, okay, this patient is euthyroid. But you should always order a free T4 alongside. And if you see the free T4, you will realize that, okay, this is again central hypothyroidism. Cortisol was done in our lab, and you can see the cortisol was only 2 microgram per dl, which is really, really low. And at such a low value, you can straight away diagnose the patient to be having adrenal insufficiency secondary to a pituitary dysfunction. And this is what had happened to this patient, actually. This is his MRI, which we fished out from his old records. he had a large apoplexy. The accident actually was probably incidental. He was just correlating, but he had an apoplexy, that is a large bleed had occurred. He probably had an macroadenoma in the pituitary, which is going up to the optic chiasm. And this bright thing, which you see on the T1 weighted image, this is the blood which is accumulated in the pituitary. And subsequently, this apoplexy led to a destruction of the pituitary tissue, and this patient ended up becoming hypopituitarism. There is something called empty cella syndrome, which again you find that the patient on an MRI does not have any pituitary tissue. Some of these patients are having hypopituitarism, but some of them may have normal pituitary function also. And the cause of the empty cell is probably they had some apoplexy, because of which the tumor or the pituitary tissue got damaged, and subsequently it necrosed, and you only got an empty cell left. So how will you diagnose hypopituitarism? We've already discussed this. Just to recap, got TSH, high TSH, slightly high TSH, normal T4, subclinical hypothyroidism, high TSH, slightly low FT4, overt hypothyroidism, markedly low FT4, but no increase in FTSH, central hypothyroidism. Apart from that, you have a low basal serum cortisol. If your serum cortisol is really low, if it is less than 7, or some people say less than 10, then straight away you need not do any further testing. You can say that this patient has got a low cortisol because of a pituitary issue probably. But in cases in which the cortisol is borderline, let's say between 10 and 18, you would want to do HTT stimulation tests to make sure that they have an adequate adrenal reserve. If the patient has got low testosterone and low estradiol, and the LHFSH are either normal, low normal, or low, then again this shows that they have got a hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. That means the pituitary is responsible for the low testosterone. So this is how you will diagnose biochemically. Treatment wise, you have to give them thyroxine. Most of them will require a full dose thyroxine, which is 1.6 microgram per kg, as you know. And then importantly, you have to titrate the thyroxine levels to the T4, not to the TSH, because the TSH is already normal. The TSH is normal. You can ask me later why TSH remains normal. I can tell you why that happens. But anyway, TSH will remain normal even without treatment. So you have to look at T4, and you have to titrate to make sure the T4 is at least in the mid-normal range and should not be low definitely. Then you give glucocorticoids, either hydrocortisone or prednisolone. We've discussed that in the lecture on adrenals. Prednisolone replacement dose is around 5 to 7.5 milligrams per day. Hydrocortisone is around 15 to 20 milligrams in an adult. And then you can give a lower dose. You best to make sure that the symptoms are not there. There is no biochemical way of estimating or titrating glucocorticoids. Then you also give them testosterone injections if in a male patient, and you check the testosterone levels. And the females have to be put on estrogen and progesterone cyclical therapy so that they have the cycles and they also maintain their bone health. Okay. Then you've got cellular masses, which I already discussed with you, pituitary adenomas, which can be functional or non-functional. And you've got craniopharyngiomas and Rathke's cleft cyst and hypothalamic tumors. So the cellular masses which you have can have effect on the surrounding structures, and these effects are shown in this table, which I've taken from one of the textbooks. In the optic chiasm, the first symptom actually will be loss of red perception, because the red fibers are on the outside. Subsequently, you develop what is called a bitemporal hemianopia, because these are the fibers which are first compressed from below, and then you can get the superior or bitemporal field effects. And then if there is further compress, you can get scotomas and blindness. If the tumor goes up further and hits the hypothalamus, you can get temperature dysregulation, you can get appetite disorders, you can get diabetes insipidus and behavioral abnormalities. In the cavernous sinus, you can get ophthalmoplegias, you can get facial numbness because of the involvement of the nerves. Then frontal lobe involvement can lead to personality disorders and anosmia. And of course, you can have headache, hydrocephalus because of the increased pressure, and you can have dementia, etc. So these are the features of the tumors. One thing, the mass can can compress the gland and lead to hormone hyposecretion or hypopituitarism. But if the tumor is a secretory tumor, then you can have the typical symptoms of hormone hypersecretion. So among the pituitary adenomas, the most common are the prolactinomas. These are the most common pituitary tumors, or rather adenomas. And the second most common are the non-functional ones. And the third most common are the growth hormone secreting. Fourth one are the TSH secreting, which are quite rare actually. And TSH secreting adenomas are actually extremely, extremely rare. Even in an endocrine carrier, you may end up seeing only a handful of the TSH secreting pituitary adenomas. Right. So instead of going to prolactinomas, I will stop here, and not stop here. Rather, go to my presentation on hyperprolactinemia, and we will then cover hyperprolactinemia along with the prolactinomas. So I will just stop the screen share for a moment, and then go back to the slides which I have on hyperprolactinemia. Yeah, so now we will talk about hyperprolactinemia. So this is linked to the pituitary, so I wanted to cover it here. So hyperprolactinemia is a common endocrine problem, and this is one of the common reasons for which we get referrals from the gynae or obstetrics OPDs. And often the patients are already having galactorrhea or amenorrhea or infertility. So what are the normal prolactin levels? In the males, the prolactin should be less than 15 nanogram per ml. And in the females, it should be less than 20 nanograms per ml. Very low prolactin levels also have their implications, but I will not go into that out here. Actually, very low prolactin level may be a marker of hypopituitarism, but I think we should not go there. We should just continue with hyperprolactinemia. So the common error which a lot of people make is that the moment they see a high prolactin level, they begin to think of a prolactinoma. But you have got to realize that while prolactinomas are common pituitary tumors, hyperprolactinemia itself is much more common. And one of the most common causes of hyperprolactinemia, especially in our setting, are drugs. So I've written drugs four times because that is the frequency with which you're going to find drugs as a cause of hyperprolactinemia. So what are these drugs which can cause hyperprolactinemia? So the common categories are antiemetics or prokinetics, such as domperidone or metoclopramide. So as you would have seen in your OPDs, a lot of people have GERD, and for that GERD, they will insist on getting some medication, and they also take these medications over the counter. A lot of these medications are a combination of pantoprazole with domperidone, and of course, some people may be taking ranitidine also. While pantoprazole itself is not supposed to be causing hyperprolactinemia, but there are some reports which say that maybe even pantoprazole can cause, although the mechanism is not clear. But these are the important causes in our practice. Most of the people are taking these drugs, and these are the real culprits behind the hyperprolactinemia. Estrogens, again, that is which happens quite often. The patients are prescribed estrogens from the gynae OPD itself, and after that they do it with the prolactin levels, which comes out to be high. And quite often ranitidine is prescribed along with some antibiotics in the OPD, and then they do the prolactin. So actually the cause and effect is both there in the same prescription. Then antipsychotics. If the patient is on haloperidol, clozapine, olanzapine, risperidone, etc., these can cause cause hyperprolactinemia. And the cause of hyperprolactinemia out here is, I hope, is clear. These are D2 receptor blockers. So these drugs tend to block the D2 receptor or the dopamine receptor. And as we discussed, the dopamine has an inhibitory effect. The dopaminergic tone inhibits the secretion of prolactin from the pituitary gland. And if you interrupt this, either by giving a blocker of the dopamine receptor, you are going to land up with hyperprolactinemia. Antidepressants, again, tricyclic antidepressants like amitriptyline, clomipramine, etc., are often being given either for neuropathic pain or for some other reasons. And these are also causes which can cause hyperprolactinemia. So drugs are not the only cause of hyperprolactinemia, although they are the most common one. You have physiological causes such as pregnancy and lactation. Typically, you should not ask for a prolactin when you are pregnant or somebody is lactating because it's got to be high. Hypothyroidism, especially uncontrolled hypothyroidism, is one important cause of hyperprolactinemia. And the reason for this is that the TRH, the TSH-releasing hormone, also stimulates the lactotrophs to produce prolactin. In renal failure, the clearance of prolactin from the blood circulation is decreased. So renal failure patients will have increased prolactin. And an important cause is pituitary stalk compression. So as we said, the pituitary stalk is the one which brings the The pituitary stalk is the one which brings the dopamine to the anterior pituitary. And therefore, if you compress the stalk by some method, you will not receive the dopamine into the pituitary. And therefore, because of the interruption of this dopaminergic tone, you will land up with hyperprolactinemia. So if you have a non-functioning tumor, or maybe a Rathke's cleft cyst, or some supracellular tumor, some other meningioma, for example, and if that tumor enlarges and it presses upon the stalk, it is going to cut off the dopamine secretion, the dopamine delivery to the anterior pituitary, and you will get hyperprolactinemia. So an important pointer to what is the etiology of hyperprolactinemia is the prolactin level itself. If the level is more than 200 nanograms per ml, then most likely you should expect to see a prolactinoma when you do an imaging. But some conditions, for example, pregnancy, you can have 200 level of 200 when the patient is in pregnancy or lactating. If the patient is taking some drugs such as risperidone has a very prominent prolactin raising effect. So in those conditions, you can get a high level. If you get a value less than 100, then you must think of drugs and you must think of the other causes which we discussed, such as hypothyroidism, etc., and renal failure. And stalk compression, again, a less than 100 value can be because stalk compression. So it is not that if you see less than 100, so it is always going to be benign. It can still be a major issue. So what you need to do typically in these cases of hypolactin is that you try to look at the drugs, try to look at other causes. If the patient is on some drugs, stop that drug and then get your prolactin done again. If your prolactin becomes normal, then you can put it as drug-induced hyperprolactinemia, which is 9 out of 10 times. But if you still your prolactin is high, then you have to think in terms of a prolactin secreting tumor if it is more than 200. And if it is less than 100, then you think of either a stalk compression or maybe a very small evolving pituitary tumor, prolactinoma, which is not now big enough to secrete 200 nanogram per ml or more. So this is how you should approach after looking at the prolactin level. So clinical features of hyperprolactinemia are amenorrhea, galactorrhea, and infertility. In males, it can present with hypogonadism. So how to take a prolactin sample again is important. Prolactin sample is to be taken in the fasting state because after meal, you may have some elevation in prolactin. Exercise should be avoided. Nipple stimulation is one cause which may increase prolactin levels in some cases. Earlier, we used to advise 3 days abstinence before going for prolactin sample, although it is no longer followed now. But if you've got a chest surgery or you've got a herpes zoster in that area, that can cause a prolonged constant nipple stimulation and you can get a false prolactin, which is high. Stress, acute stress can increase prolactin levels. And even venipuncture stress, if it is there, if it's a very painful venipuncture, you can get a slightly high prolactin level. So these things have to be looked at when you are considering the elevated prolactin. Prolactin sample should be either stored at 2 to 8 degrees or it can even be frozen. But if you leave it at room temperature for long periods of time, then you might get a falsely low value. So this is something that is important. These peptide hormones are sensitive to temperature. And if you want to send a sample from your ward for prolactin, then you must ensure that a cold chain is there. You cannot just send it in without a proper cold chain. You may get a falsely low value. So this is how prolactin test is done. This is actually a standard immunoassay, how it is performed. Whenever you order a hormone level, this is what is basically happening. You've got the streptoviridin-coated microparticles, and the streptoviridin-coated microparticles are bound to the antibody against prolactin. This purple thing is the antibody to prolactin. And you've got another antibody to prolactin, which is bound to ruthenium molecules. So what happens is a sandwich forms. This is called a sandwich immunoassay. So the streptoviridine is bound to the wall. And then this is the antiprolactin antibody. The prolactin is in the middle. And then this antibody comes and binds from the other side. And if you got more of prolactin, then more of this binding will occur and you will get more of ruthenium. If you got less prolactin, then you will have less of ruthenium. And then the electrical current is passed and then the ruthenium molecules gives a signal, and that is the electrical signal is recorded. And the quantity of that signal helps you to tell how much prolactin is there in this sample. So this is how sample testing is performed. And actually the similar thing is done for most of the other hormone assays as well. So they are all immunoassays. You got immunoassay because it uses antibodies, and electrochemiluminescence because it uses electricity to generate chemiluminescence, and which is measured, and that gives you indirectly the amount of hormone in the blood sample. Right, so prolactinomas, as we said, they are common. Let's skip this. So prolactinomas are generally small. They're microprolactinomas, but they can enlarge. And again, as we discussed earlier, depending upon the way that they enlarge, you can have the effects. If it enlarges upwards, you will have visual defects, hydrocephalus. Sideways, it will involve the cavernous sinus, and downwards, it can cause nasal obstruction and CNSS rhinorrhea also. And then again, it can also cause proptosis if it moves forward. It can also involve the temporal lobe and cause hearing defects, etc. So this is an MRI image which is showing a huge prolactin secreting tumor. So you can see these things can get pretty big in size. You cannot even see the barely see the pituitary tissue out here. I can't even see the optic chiasm. And so this is another image of the MRI, which is showing a temporal lobe and pons invasion by the tumor. And this is one which is showing the orbital invasion. Okay, so I think we are running out of time in this session. So let me stop it here, and then we can log into the second session.